Okay, good morning. So my name is Joris van den Bossen, and I'm going to give you a introduction to pandas tutorial. Just to start, who has already used pandas before? Some of you. There are so many who didn't use. Oops, I forgot to confirm. So it will be, I will do some explanations. There are also a lot of exercises. So we are going to do, as I showed before, the pandas introduction notebook. So the first one. There is a lot of more material. We are only going to do. We are only going to do the first tutorial. And if you want to do more notebooks in similar style exercises, and the solutions are always provided as well, you have a lot more material there. So the first notebook. So just to show you that I don't have to explain it later. So there are exercises, it's always in green, that are the exercises that I would like you to try yourself. My advice is to first try yourself. I will later on also go over them. But if you already want to look at the solution after you try it, you can uncomment this one and run the cell. Then you will see one possible solution. So, for example, if you are already a bit familiar and want to go a bit faster, you can do the exercise and look at what I provided as a possible solution. Okay, but I will start with the So, to start, for those who are not familiar with pandas, I'm going to give a quick introduction about this and why you would use it by starting with the showcase. So, for example, I have some data about the Titanic passengers and whether they survived. So, I can read the CSV file with pandas, and I can easily look at the data. There are several columns, and what I can do with pandas is very easily, with such kind of tabular data, look at my data and ask some questions. For example, what is the age distribution of passengers, or how did the percentage of people that survived, how did it differ between, for example, males and females, and you see there's quite some difference, or how did it differ for the different classes of the passengers. So you can very quickly look at your data, analyze your data, manipulate your data. No worries about what I did here exactly. We are going through the notebook and you are going to be able to do that in the end. That's one data set. Another data set is about some air quality measurements, so a time series of hourly measurements of the air quality in a few Paris monitoring stations. And also with time series pandas, it's very easy to use the time series, so you can look, for example, at how the trend looks like with the monthly averages over the different years, and you see a small decrease, slight decrease, or with yearly averages like this. Or we can look at whether there are, how the diurnal pattern, the typical concentrations over a day, and you see in a week, day, you see the typical concentration peaks during the morning and the evening rush. So, but we'll come back to those. So, what is pandas? You already, I suppose that most of you followed yesterday also the Python and NumPy introduction tutorials. So, NumPy arrays, they can only have one data type. In many, often when you have real world data, you often have tabular-like data, like having a SQL database or a spreadsheet in Excel, and often your columns have different data types. So that's something that Pandas brings to. So based on NumPy, it provides a table-like structure, like very similar to in R, the data fit in R, where you have different columns that can have different data types, and also where your columns have names that you can use. If you have such kind of data, then Pandas provides many functionality to import those data, to clean up the data, to process, explore, analyze, etc. So it's specifically targeted to tabular 1D or 2D data. But of course, just to be aware, not all data fits in such a structure. For example, array data, if you have images, or if you work with sort of numerical algorithms, just stick to NumPy. You shouldn't work with Pandas for such data. To start, so the basic data structure that Pandas provides is the data frame in series. So the data frame is the table, the 2D table, where you have your data is inside, we have some column names, and we also have an index, which are the row labels. So if you look at the data frame we had before, due to that I assumed the presentation is not that nice, but you see here that we have our column names, different column names, and these are our row labels. If you want to look at those attributes, so we can access what the column names are or what the index is through those attributes. The index is just a default range, but we will later see that we can also set some other data as the row labels. And you can also access the column names, also the column names, where you can see different column names. As I explained, so the data frame can hold different data types. So the dtypes attribute can actually see that each column has its own data type. And we have some integers, some flow data. The object that you see there, that's often if you have strings, a column with strings, then you will see that it has an object dtype. Another method that gives a bit an overview of what is inside the data frame is a .info method, where you see a bit combination of all the info before, the different data types, how many values there are inside each column that are not missing, and some other information. You also have the .values attribute, which gives you the underlying array, but in case of a data frame, it's not always that useful, because as I said, so NumPy can only have one data type, and this will give you data with different data types inside an array, so it's not that useful in this case to get the actual array. I read the data frame, I created the data frame by reading it from a CSV file. There are many other ways you can create a data frame. Another way is, for example, by passing a dictionary to the data frame object, where your keys of the dictionary will be the column names and the values, the different columns. For example, in this way I can make a small data frame. The data frame is a 2D object, the series is a 1D object, or for example, if you access a single column of your data frame, then you get back a 1D series. How can you access such a column? Using just square brackets and the column name. For example, if I want to access the age column, this is now a series. You see a small difference in the representation in the notebook. In that way, you can very quickly see whether it's a series or a data frame. The data frame has a HTML representation, and the series is just a text representation. I'm going to assign that series to a variable age. So just like the data frame, also the series has an index in this case is the same, and has some underlying values which are stored in the non-primary. We can, as we can do with non-primaries, we can access certain elements of the series by indexing. For example, I want the first element. But as I already mentioned, now the index is just a default range from 0 up to the length minus 1. But you can also use row labels that actually have a meaning. If you want to set a certain column of your data frame as the index, you can use the setIndex method, like this. So now you will see, here in bold, it's now not anymore 0, 1, up to the length, but the names of the people that the different passengers. And if you then get back the series for the age, you see now the index are of different names, and you can access a certain very similar to a dictionary a bit. You can access the age of a person based on bypassing that name. That's something you could do with a dictionary in Python, but what you can't do with a dictionary is very easily do element-wise operations as you would do with a non-primary. So for example, I can multiply each element in the series thousands, or there are also a bunch of minutes available in the data frame in the series to do all kinds of operations. For example, I can take the average age of the passengers, so the average age of all Titanic passengers was almost 30 years. What we can also do is, for example, for indexing, it's Boolean indexing. So if I do something like this, age is bigger than 70. So it's a comparison which will also work element-wise, and it will return a series with false and true. And we only see here false, but there are also true values. If you have such a condition which generates a series of false or true values, we can also use that to filter our original data frame. Like this, if you pass this between the square brackets, we can select all people who are older than 70, all passengers of the Titanic with such an age. And there are many methods available on a pandas data frame and series. Too many to all go into detail, but if you do time completion, you will see that there are quite a lot. But the typical mathematical functions, for example, to take the maximum age or the minimum age, and all those typical things that you would expect are all available. There are also some, most of the methods, for example, you know, you've maybe learned in NumPy, and those minimum, maximum, median, mean functions are also available on pandas objects. But there are also some additional ones, some typical ones for data frames. For example, we have the value counts method, which is just this account of the values which are inside the column. So it will give you the count, so in this embarked column, which stands for the place where people embarked on the Titanic, and it will count, there are 644 rows that have the value S, etc. So, there's a lot of talk, but let's try to actually do some use pandas yourself. So there are two small exercises to just start using it a little bit. Also to say, if there are any questions when I'm speaking, just interrupt, raise your hand, or during the exercise, please ask questions. In the pandas introduction, so the first bit, number one. Is not there?
No.
Maybe you need to download it, because I only updated it yesterday evening, rather late. So it's maybe the reason. Well, it was a little bit after 12, so... do you have internet or otherwise a stick can come around? Okay, yeah, so for the people who did before, today you have to... But what you can... this to download again. There are people who still need to update. Oh, here's a stick. Okay, I will go to the exercise. So the first question was, what is the maximum fare that a passenger paid? So we have a data frame. We want to know something about the fare column. So how do we access the fare column? We use square brackets and we use negatives. So this gives us the column, all the values of the fares that we paid. And then we can just use a method on the series to know the maximum or to know median value, like this. So you see that the maximum is quite a bit larger than the median. Something we could also have done to explore the fares is to make a histogram of it to see the actual distribution of the. In this case, we would maybe make some custom binning and it's just a default, how the default binning is set up. Okay. Second question was, what is the average survival ratio of all passengers? So, if you look at the survived column, you can see it are zeros and ones. So I didn't really explain it explicitly, but zero means person is dead, one means he survived. So what we actually want to do is we want to count the number of ones in this column. So there are some different ways to count something. In principle, if you want to count something, you could do a value count, as I showed before. But if you want to count something very specific, you could do like this. Check which values are equal to 1, which gives you a series of true and false. And then you want to take a sum of this to know how many true values there are. You could do like this, and then take a sum. This gives us all the number of passengers who survived. That's in general, but of course we already had zeros and ones. So we can actually just take the sum of our column, which will give you the same. But with the other method to look how many are equal to something is more general, you can use that for any value. If you want to know the percentage, you have to divide by the total number. For the total number of rows, one way to get this is the length of the data frame. this length of the data frame will give you the number of rows. If we execute this and we see there was around 38% of the passengers survived the Titanic. Yes, so you can indeed see, and you take the sum and divide the length. In this case, it's of course, we can, to calculate the same, you can take the mean of this column, like that. Okay, any questions so far about those exercises? Then we'll go a bit more in detail, give some explanation about data import and export. So we already read the CSV file, but there is a wide range of data formats that pandas can read or also write. And so but in general, what you need to know, all the import methods are called pd.reads. Something. So if you do tab completion on this, you will see there are quite some. So we have, we can read from SQL, from SAS, we can HTML tables from the internet, we can read Excel files, CSV files, Stata, if you would have Stata data. In the latest release, there is also the Parquet format which can be read. So all read methods, pd.reads. All export methods are your data frame dot to, and then similar to a certain format. So to CSV, to Excel, to HTML. If you want to the LaTeX table, you can do that as well, or to SQL, to Stata, etc. So that are the export methods. The read CSV function is, I think, one of the most used functions of pandas, and it's also a very powerful or complex, you could say, function. If you look at the help, you will see you have quite some options. You could say that's a very bad design, but unfortunately many people have the weirdest kind of CSV files, and we can say the pandas read CSV can read most of those weird things. But luckily, so there are many options that you can look into if you have some kind of special CSV file. But luckily, if you have just a normal CSV file, comma separated, header, things like that, you don't need those options. We already read the CSV file. If you would look at the actual data, this is just a nice, normal CSV file, and then it reads fine without providing any options. I have another data file. It's this one. This is a bit more specific. You can see if I maybe can show it. So it's this one. So here, I can't make it larger. But you can see, so it has some special things which are default. It has two header files because there is some kind of units on the second row, so we'll have to skip this. You see it's also with semicolons and not with commas. And there are also some dates that we might want to parse. And the missing value representation is n/d. Not fully sure what it stands for, maybe no data or something. But so there are all things that you can specify in the read CSV function. So you can try to read this file into a data frame using read CSV. So to remember, if you want to look at the different parameters, you can, in a notebook, either use Shift Tab to see the help, and you can look at, for example, every lead to specify the separator, the delimiter that was used. For this, we can use the set keyword. What we also need is, the formatting is not very good. So Shift Tab. If you are inside the function, you do Shift Tab, and then you get this. Another way to do it, to get it in a bit easier to read format, or you can of course look online in the documentation page, is to put a question mark after, then execute the cell, then you get here below something that you can also read. So what we, for example, also will need here is a skip rows argument, where you can pass a list of rows to skip. So what are the things that we need? We needed to specify that the separator is a comma separated, and you want to skip the second row, which is row number one, because the help said it was started to count at zero. So if I execute this one, and I see that I already have some nicely formatted data frame. The only thing, I still here see n/d, which is a string in a numeric column, so I don't want that. There is, so the exercise notes to check the NA values keywords. So if we look at that one, NA values somewhere here. So a scalar or a list like, so additional strings to recognize as a missing value. And there are a bunch of strings, an empty string, or all those strings are recognized as missing values. But the n/d is not in there, so we can also provide this, and it values this n/d. And now you will see here it's an actual missing value. We use the not a number, this is NaN stands for, but that's, so there's a NumPy NaN value which we use as an indicator for missing values in pandas. Right. So, very short, just to show that you can tweak quite a lot for the when you are reading a CSV file with the pandas. And apart from that, we have many other import and export functions. There's one last thing. This is a time series, and I'd like to have my index my timestamps as the index. For that, I can also specify that my index column should be the first column, so not column number zero. And then you will see timestamps are now inside the index. And the last thing, but that's something you really need to know. If I want to actually parse those dates, I can also say parse dates is true, because now it will still be strings, they're just a CSV file, it's text data, but with parse dates is true, I say to pandas, let's try to parse those values I set as the index to actual dates. Like that. Now the representation looks the same, but now it are actual, if you look at the index, you'll see our actual date time index, but that's something for later. If you didn't fully write this, you can always look here at the solution, which will do the normally the same. Yes. So the NO2 file so it are measurements of air quality, nitrogen dioxide, therefore I used NO2, of some stations in Paris. So it has quite some data. If you look at the length, it has more than 100,000 rows in the data frame. So we have some methods in pandas to quickly explore a bit of data. So something that you can use is head, the head function, which by default will give you the first 5 rows of a data frame. You can also specify how many you want. You can say I want the first step. I set my display to only show 8 rows, because normally the default is to show 60 rows. And I put in the first cell, if you executed that, I changed the option to pandas to only show a limited amount, because it's easier to work with in the tutorial. But then by default it shows 60 rows, and then a head function to show the first 5 can be very useful. The same if you want to see the last ones. So you see it starts at the January of 2000, and the data go up to the end of 2016. Info already showed above. You can see how many values there are. You can also see there are some missing values, how much memory takes the data frame. We also have a describe method, which gives you a bit the summary statistics of the different columns. So you can see how many values, the average standard deviation, some of the different quartiles in the dataset. So that's a way to get the summary statistics all at once. You can also quickly look a bit, visualize some of the data. I already showed the histogram function, but the general plot function is just the plot method. So by default, if you use plot, if I would do this, we get a line plot of all the columns. In this case, because there are many many rows, it takes a while to plot this with Matplotlib, and you also don't see that much because there are more than 100,000 data points on for each line of the plot. But so the default is just to plot the different columns as a line plot. But with the kind keyword, you can specify some different plot types. For example, you can see here, the line plot is the default, but we can make a bar plot, a histogram, a box plot, a pie plot in case you would want that, although I don't recommend that, a scatter plot, etc. So in this case, we take of each column a box plot, which gives you a bit an idea of the distribution of each of the different sections. Or of a single one, you can take, for example, the histogram of the distribution of the measurements. Right. Okay, so small exercise to go back to the Titanic dataset. So we call this, normally it's still in your memory, it's called DF. And let's now try to plot the age distribution of the passengers of the Titanic. The age and the age column can access it like this. We want to plot this. A default line plot won't make much sense, so we can say we want another kind of plot, a histogram, for example, to get distribution. For the histogram, we also have the hist method, which will do the same, which is a shortcut for a histogram. But for the other plot types, you need to pass it as a kind to the these are already mentioned. The default is a line plot, so I will go to the next section. So I already showed some data frames, how to explore them, but very often you want to do some subsetting of your data frame. You want to select certain rows of your data frame, and Because pandas uses labels for the rows and columns, we introduce some complexity because we can select both by those labels and by our column names or by our row labels, but we can still, just like with NumPy, we can also select a certain part of a data frame based on the position, right? Whether it's the first, the second, third row, etc. So we have two ways to select data, by label or by position. And because there are two ways, and sometimes you can mix them a bit, then that gives a bit of complexity to indexing in pandas, but of course, being able to select by label is also very powerful. So, up to now, we always selected some data using just the square brackets. So, that provides some convenience shortcuts to select a single column, and that's what we already did up to now. Like this gives you a single column. We can also use it to select multiple columns by passing a list. So you will see now it looks like you have the double square brackets, but it's just a list that you provide. Here, this is the list of columns inside the square brackets to index. So you end up with double square brackets. So this gives you a subset of columns of your data frame. What we also can do is slice the rows. So on one hand, you can select some columns, one or multiple. If we provide a slice or a Boolean mask, it will not select from the columns, but from the rows. So for example, around rows 10 up to this, in this case, position also from 10 up to 14, so the five columns rows there. This is rather limited because either you select column or either you can slice rows, but of course you want to do some combinations and therefore you have the lock and ilock methods, attributes. So just as we have two different ways to select by label or by position. So therefore we have two different attributes, lock to select by label, ilock to select by position. So I will set the name column as my index. So I have, don't have just a default integers, not anymore as my index, but actual names. And if I now want to do some sub-selection, it's always inside lock. You first pass how you want to subset the rows, and then how you want to subset the columns. So, like this. This is always the pattern, the row indexer, comma, column indexer. If you only want to select the rows, you can leave out the columns. But if you want only to select the columns using lock, you have to provide just a column for a full slice, give me all the rows, and then I can select something from the columns. So this is the pattern how you use dot lock. It's the same for ilock. What can this be, those rows and columns? Similar as we already have seen, it can be a single element. And a single scale to access one element. It can be a list to to subset, select several rows or columns, or it can also be a slice, or it can be a Boolean mask. So a small example. For example, now here, this is my row label. This is my column name label. So I just pass two single elements. So this will just access a single element from the data frame. But in the second example, for example, what I do here, I pass a slice from Mrs. Elizabeth until Mr. Anders, and then I say, give me all columns for this slice. So this will give you a subset of the rows, but all columns. Very similar with ilock. Row indexer, comma, column indexer, but now we just use integers and it's Just like with a numpy array, you can, in this case, you can do some slicing, but also here you could use pass a list, for example, the second and some other columns, for example, like this, and that will work as well. So that selects some columns. Up to now I showed how to get some data. The same syntax you can use to also assign data to the data frame. For example, if you want to update a certain value, if you look at the data frame, so it's actually the first one. Here are low values, so if I now set this to 100, the survived column, and you will see now this value has been updated. So similarly, with slices or mask of lists, you can do a selection and assign a value to that selection. Yeah, so this is something that I already showed and mentioned before. So with if you do some certain kind of Boolean condition, for example, where the fair is bigger than 50, this gives you true or false values, and that's a Boolean mask, which we can use to index our data frame. You can do it like this, by passing it to square brackets, or you can also do it inside .log, and it will give you the same. And then you can, for example, combine it with, I want to access the survived column, like this. Okay, let's do some exercise on this indexing. Okay, so let's try the first exercise. You have a data frame, and the question is, select all rows for male passengers and calculate the mean age of those passengers. So how do we select all the rows for the male passengers? We have a column called sex, and we want those that are equal to male. So we can do this with comparison where they are equal to male, and this condition will give us true and false values. It gives us a Boolean mask with which we can subset our data frame. And this, let's call this the, for example, the males, like this. So this will give us all the rows of the data frame only where the sex is equal to male. Next, it asks the mean age of those passengers, the males. So we can get the age column and we calculate the mean. And now I did it in two different steps, but and this is a selection of the rows, this is a selection of the column. I could have also done this in one step using the block. So always rows, columns. So what is my row selection? That is this Boolean mask where the sex is equal to male. What is my column selection? That is the age column. Like this, this will give us all the ages of the males, and we can calculate the mean of this. And then doing the same for the females. So you see the females are a little bit younger than this. Second question was to count how many passengers were older than 17. So we want to know something about the age, we get the age column. But we want to know whether this is whether those this age is larger than 17. So therefore we can use again a comparison. And this gives us the false and true values. What we could do is subset our data frame and get look at those. And it gives us a few rows. What we could do is count the number of the number of rows that are inside this data frame. How do you know the number of rows? We can use the length of the data frame, which gives us 5. But of course, I showed this before. If we just want to count the number of values inside the number of true values, whether some expression is true, some condition is true, we can take the sum, which in this case is a bit easier. We don't have to actually do the subset on our data frame to know the number of rows we would get. Okay, so that's very short and some introduction to getting subset of your data. If you look at the solution that we have here for the first exercise, so we calculated the mean for one condition, calculated the mean for a second condition, and for the different values in that column of male and female. So that's a very typical thing you want to do. You want based on you want to group your records, your rows by a certain column, and for the different groups do kind of operation. In this case, you want to take the mean. Because it's a very common operation, there is some functionality to do that much easier than write this fully yourself. And certainly, if you would have more options than only male and female, writing in dark like this would be very tedious. So, what I said was grouping by a certain column. In this case, the groups are male and female, and then applying a certain operation. This is called the group by operation. So, so let's, as an example, look at the small data frame. So, it's this data frame with a certain key ABC, so that are our groups, and some values. So we can take a sum of a certain column, but as I just said, you typically want to take the sum for the different groups. To not have to write it on multiple lines, we could do also a for loop like this. So here we print the sums of the different groups. But of course, we don't have to do that in a different way. So therefore, we want to do the goodbye operation. Here is just a figure which illustrates a bit what actually happens under the hood. If you have a data frame and you split first into different data frames based on a certain column, in this case a key column, so you have a subset data frame with all the A's, all the B's, all the C's. Then you apply the function that you want, in this case a sum on each group. This gives us 15 for the first one, 30 for the second one, 45 for the C's, and then you combine them again in a resulting data frame. So therefore, this kind of operation is also sometimes called split, apply, combine. Also in SQL, you have such a group by operation. So how does this look like? And this operation, how does it look like in Pandas? We have a group by method on our data frame. What do you pass to group by? You pass the name of the column. It's one of the options, but you can pass the name of the column on which you want to base your different groups. In this case, it was the key column. Next, what you then, as a method on this result, you can specify how you want to aggregate, which function you want to apply. So in this case, we can take the sum like this. So there are quite some methods available on a goodbye object. So you could also do median here, or you could take the minimum. So many of the typical reduction methods that you can do just on a data frame, and you can also do on a goodbye operation. You can also, by using the aggregate methods, pass a custom function. In this case, I reused again sum. Or for the default ones, you could also specify it as a string. And so the default ones, sum, median, max, min, are recognized and as well. But here you can pass any kind of function that if it's passed the data frame, that does a kind of aggregation. And there are many more methods available if you want to select it on a single column, because by default this function will be applied on each column. In the small example there is only one column, but if you will apply it on the Titanic data, so there are many columns. If you want to apply our function only on a single column, you can, as we would select a single column from a data frame, you can also do it here. You could of course put it at the end as well, but then by putting it before applying the function, is to select first the column on the group by operation. In this way you avoid that the actual calculations happens for the other columns. Okay, that's the group by operation, how it works. So let's now try this out on the Titanic dataset. So what we did before was to calculate the average age for each sex, for the female and the males. So if you remember, we did it here on those two lines. So let's now get the same results, those 30 and 27 or 28, but using group by.
Thank you.
Okay, we'll go through the different exercises. So the first was to do the same as we did before, the average age for each sex. So we use group by. We want to group by males, females, so we group by the sex couple. And we want to take the average. By default, this will take the average of each column. So if you only want the average age, you can select the age like this, and then it will only give us the average age. So you see, and we have the 28, 30.7, as we had before, but now much easier to calculate. Very similar as this one, calculate average survival ratio of all passengers. So this one is just to remind you that if you want the survival, the percentage of people that survived, we can just take the mean. So on average, it was 38%. But so if you want to know this for the different passengers, we can calculate this survival ratio bit for different subsets. This one just asks for the survival ratio of all passengers younger than 25. So for this, we don't need a group by because we just want to subselect based on the age all those that are younger than 25 and take the mean of the age column here. So if I do now mean again, it will take the of all columns, the mean of all columns. I only want the survived ratio, so I can select both the rows and the columns by using log. And like this, now I get only the survival ratio. So you see, the younger people had a slightly higher chance to survive the Titanic.
Since you could also do that without the log and just missing and then missing again.
Yeah, indeed.
Why would you prefer one over the other?
So what I did first was this. I made a subset of my data frame. So this actually, if you leave out the mean, this gives you again a data frame. So and based on this subset of data frame, what I want to do is select a single column and take the mean of that. And so if you just do it sequentially, you can do it like that. It will just work as well, only I need to take the survive to have the same value like that. So this works perfectly as well to get some data and calculate something on it. So for this exercise, it's just that good. The only thing that you have to be aware of, this is called chained indexing, because we chain different indexing operations. The thing that you have to be aware of that if you do this and you want to assign a certain value, you want to set values, not only get them to calculate something, but to assign values, that you can get into trouble. While if you do it like this, this will also work to assign something. For example, if I would have put all the values for the survive column for the people younger than 25 to another value, I can do this. Can do that with log. With this chained indexing, it might work or it might not work, depending on what kind of subselection you do. Very short, for those who want to know, the reason for this is because the first operation, depending on what you subselect, can be actually a copy of the data frame. And then the second selection that you do, you're selecting, not making a selection on the original data frame, but actually on a copy of it. And if you then assign a value, you're assigning a copy and not in the original one. That's already a bit more advanced topic, but by using those chained indexing, you can get into trouble with that. If you're using the look like here, that should be no problem.
I also just saw the second version with a lot of actually faster for me. maybe because you can do the whole thing in one step rather than having to index.
Yeah, it's possible. So, next was, what is the difference in survival ratio between the sexes? So, again, we group by the sex column, but now we want to calculate the mean of the survived column lives. And so you can see, actually, females have a much higher chance to survive than the males. Next question, can we do the same, but now not for the sex, but for the different classes? So we had the first class, second and third class on the Titanic, and we can also calculate the survival ratio for this. So what we do, just replace the sex with the class, which was called P class, I think. So if I do this, you see the different values for the classes. And also ask, can you make a bar plot it for a little bit more visual? So what we do on the results, we do a plot, a bar plot like this. So now we get visually, you see that the people who paid more, which are in the higher, in the first class, have the higher chance to survive than the people in the lower, the higher classes. Finally, there is the last exercise that you have something provided, because the question was, can you make a bar plot to visualize the average fare that people pay depending on their age? What I provided here is using the cut function. The cut function is a function in pandas. If you have a column with numerical values and you want to bin it somehow, you can use the cut function. So if I execute this and I look at this function, you will see now every value which had an actual age now has a class assigned to it. So whether it's between 20 and 30, between 30 and 40, etc. So now we made our numerical column, our continuous column, we made it a bit column. And this way we can, for example, group by this column. So H class, we wanted to know, the question was the average fare, so we take the fare column, take the mean, like this. So now we have the value for each class, and again we can make a plot of it, like this. So here you see now, for the different classes, each class is the price that they hit. Could of course add to in the same line as the previous examples, we could look at the survived column. So you will see the for the different ages how it looks, how many people survived. So what I did here is providing the actual bin edges. So if I remove this, it's a missing argument, but what I could also do is say I just run 10 bins, for example, but then it will, I think in equal bins, just divide the from min to the maximum in equal bins, which gives you a bit like this, which are not very nice bins. So what you can do is here provide the actual the different edges of the bins. The way that it was, I said I went from 0 up to 90 steps of 10. So 0, 10, 20, etc. Then it will give us a bit nicer bits. Okay, are there any more questions related to goodbye? Or all the previous things we saw? Then I will go to a last topic I want to show you, and this a bit with time series data. It's also something that Anders provides some functionality for to easily work with that kind of data. So we previously already practiced how to read the CSV file with the air quality data. So you can't see it on the screen here, but I set the first column as the index and I parse the dates. So if I look at the first data, you will see that now I have here my timestamps in my index. So if I look at the index, it will say date time index. So if you have a time series and you want to make use of the functionality that Pandas provides for time series data, you have to make sure that your index is an actual date time index and not just, for example, the strings that are representing the different date times. So here you see the date time index. And one of the things that it makes possible is that you can very easily select a subset of the data. So as we did before with the slice, but instead of providing actual timestamp objects or datetime objects, because Pandas knows it's a datetime index, so what you pass there, I will try to parse it as a date. So you can specify it as a string, and it will be interpreted by Pandas as actual timestamps. So if I, for example, in this case, I want to slice my full data frame, and I ask for the hours from 9 up to including 12 o'clock of January 1st up to the 10th, and so I can read like this. So that makes it a bit easier to index your time series, the ability that you can pass strings here. A bit more magical feature is that you don't have to provide the full string. So here I specified up to the hour because my data has an hourly frequency. But you can also, if you make a short string, which is called a partial datetime string, Pandas will interpret this as, okay, I ask from January up to March, so it go from beginning of January up to the end of March. This is a bit of convenience feature that you can use to quickly subset certain data. I could also do the same with, for example, the years. If I want to have the all data of 2012 and 2013, I can do it like this, so from the 1st of January of 2012 up to the end of 2013. Something else that is very useful is that we have on our index, so our index is a datetime index, and typically you want to know something about your index. For example, you want to get the hour of each timestamp to, for example, select all the records of a specific hour. So you can access those as attributes. And all the typical things you want to know about your timestamps are available. For example, the hour, you can also get, as I showed below, the year. For example, there are things with a week. Oops, my top completion is a bit slow. For example, the week, day, week of the year. The week, day will give you a numeric value, whether it was a Monday, Tuesday, etc., or to Sunday, etc. Also, the minutes. In this case, it will be all zero, of course, which we hadn't, means, etc. So that's very convenient to access some information about your timestamps. If you plot all those series, so you see we had actually, I already showed this plot before, because we have an hourly frequency of our times, of our time series, this plot is not that useful. But often you want to convert the frequency of your time series to something else. For example, instead we have 1 hour frequency of our time series, and maybe we want to calculate daily average concentrations. Instead of hourly concentrations, I want daily concentrations. For that, there is a specific method which is called resample. So to resample your time series to another frequency. So if you look at the data, we have hourly data. So for each hour, we have the concentration. The resample method works very similar as goodbye. So what we do, we say dot resample, we specify the new frequency that you want as a result, and then you specify the method to calculate the new value. Because if you go from hourly frequency to daily, we have to somehow aggregate our 24 values in this case. So and then again, you have a lot of methods that you can specify, like mean, median, minimum, maximum, etc. So if I execute this, you will see the results. It's now average concentrations for each day for the different columns. And then again, you can here put different ones, for example, minimum, or other methods are available as well. You can also, so this string that you have to provide here, you can specify any frequency. There is a link here for the different strings that you can use for them, but the main ones that you can typically use, for example, the hourly is just a capital H, but we already have hourly. You can go to daily. You can also go to monthly. Now I have an average value with each month. For example, in our plot this now, we have monthly data. If you want to have yearly data, it's not capital Y, but it's the A of annual. Like this, so now I have averages for each year. And what you can also do is, if you would like that, to have to multiply the frequency. For example, I can say every 2 months. That will also work. Yeah, those are really short. So, to end this tutorial, let's do some exercises based on this data set, so the air quality data set, using the functionality that we have seen up to now. For the first one, and for the yearly averages, you can just use resample. There is also in question also to add to plot the overall average, which I mean the average of the 4 different stations. To first calculate this, there is specified here, and maybe show this. So if you want to calculate, it's probably not 2. So if you take the mean, by default, it will take the mean of each column. So in this case, you get just 4 values. If you want to take the mean not of each column, but of each row, you can pass the axis keyword to specify a different direction that you want to take the average. So for example, like this. Now you will see, instead of 1 value for each column, I get 1 value for each row, which is the average of the 4 different stations. Yeah, so by default, if you don't pass anything, it takes the average of each column. This actually, if you look at the documentation, you see that, yeah, you don't see the default. For some reason, that's not good. They should add it to the documentation. So if somebody wants to do a PR, a pull request to pandas to provide a default here, it would be a nice contribution. But the default is to take, is actually zero. So this means in this case, I want to take the average along my index. So for each column, I want to have one value. That's the default. That's typically if you, for most of the methods, for example, the minimum, maximum, etc., they all will take an aggregation for one column. By saying, passing here one, it says I want to take the average along my columns. So over the different columns, so for each row, I want to have one value. If we do this, we will see now, instead of having a single value for each column, I have now a single value for each row, like this, which will be the mean of the four different columns. We can, for example, add this to our data frame as maybe average, like this, and then you will see now we have a new column in our data frame with the average value of the four other columns. So I'll go, because it's almost time, I will go through the some of the exercises. So the question was here, can we plot the evolution of the yearly averages? So how do we do this? We use resample. We say we want yearly averages by resampling the A for annual and then taking the mean. This will give us yearly averages, and then we can make a plot of this. Right. So in the original one, in the solution, you will see here, I did it separately in two lines, so it didn't assign the new column to give a bit of styling to the specific, to the overall mean, to edit some other lines. So now you see it to give it a bit a thicker and black line. For the other exercises, I'm going to drop again this column. How do you drop a column from a data frame? It's maybe also nice to show otherwise. So you have a drop method, which takes a single column or multiple columns. The only tricky thing is that if you want to drop a column, you have to specify axis is zero. Because that by default it will try to drop a row of your data frame. Like this, and if you now look at our data frame, it has again the four original columns. You can now, of course, always just redo the read CSV to get the original column. Data frame. So the next exercise asks for the typical monthly profile for the different stations. So how do we do this? It's in this case not with a resample, but you actually want to take the average concentration for all the different months over the different years, because we want to have the typical average concentration of January. So we want to have the average of January of 2014, but also of 2015, 2016, and all the other years we have. So how can we do that? We actually have, remember that we have the month available as an attribute of our index. So this gives us those numbers, and it's actually we want to group by those numbers. We can do that by assigning a new column in our data frame, and then we can use group by. We can use group by the month and take the average, and let's directly plot it. So you see now we have one value for the 12 different months, and you see the typical pattern throughout the year, where you see that the air quality is a little bit better during the summer and a bit worse in the winter. Typically because NO2 is also emitted for heating, and in the winter we have the atmospheric conditions are so that air quality is more trapped locally than in the summer. In this case, we assigned this to a new column, and then we did group by on the column. So up to now, we always specify the column name. In this case, I would also have done it in one step without assigning a new column, by just passing this month attribute directly. So if you pass a series or an array with the same shape, it will just directly use those values. So you don't always, if it's some calculation or an attribute, you don't always have to set it first at the column to then point to that column. So this will do exactly the same. Very similar, if you want to look at the typical diurnal pattern, so the daily pattern, how the concentrations vary over the day, we can do the same, but instead by looking at the average monthly value, we can look at the average hourly value. So I can do the same as here, but I use here the hour to group by, and then we see this. Yeah. Now, because by default it uses all columns, you see the month column, but we can drop that again or select the other columns if you want to have a nice plot. And here you see the typical concentrations, how they evolve during the day. So you see the morning peak and the morning rush hour, because NO2, nitrogen dioxide, is mainly traffic related. So you typically you see the morning and evening rush in those concentrations.
So it's actually best to breathe only during the night.
Yes, at around 4 o'clock is the best time. But yes, you can also see, and there are 4 different stations, and I'm not fully familiar with the locations, but those ones are traffic locations. They are all in Paris, so you can also see that there are quite some difference whether you are on a street with a lot of traffic or somewhere else in Paris with probably less traffic, so there can be a much higher variation between locations than you get on one location during the day. This last one I'm not going to fully show anymore because it's take time to go to eat. But most things you already have seen, there's only a small extra thing that I will just show. So we use in this case not the month or hour attribute but the weekday. Then I want to know, I want to subset my data based on whether it's a weekday or a weekend day. So how do I do this? I create a new column, true or false, and I use the isIn method. What is the isIn method doing? It will give you true or false whether this value, which I just calculated, it's a weekday number, whether it's in this list of 5 and 6. 5 and 6 is for Saturday and Sunday. So this will give you true and false values. What I can now do is group by 2 different things. Up to now, we always group by a single key, a single column. But you can group by multiple columns, and then the groups will be based on all possible combinations of the two columns. So in this case, I will, for both weekdays and weekend days, I will take the average of all the different hours of the day. This will give you, the weekend is not the nicest representation, but because false means week, and true is weekend. We could replace it with nicer labels, but you will see that right now for false, all different hours, and if you look at the tail, for example, there it's the last ones for the true. If you now would like to make a plot of this, so what I do here, and this is something that I didn't expect, but I just want to show the possibility, you can reshape your data frame, and in this case I use unstack to say, okay, if I only look at the bash station, so I have the false and true values and the different hours, which are both my index. It's a index with two levels, but I want to rearrange them that I have two columns with the true and false for the week and the weekend, and my index just the different hours. Such a reshaping, in this case, I can use unstack, which will, now it's a stacked, so this is stacked under each other, and I'm going to unstack it like this, and now we have just, so it goes further up to 23, one column for the week, one column for the weekend, and we can then make a nice plot of this like this. So this is just to end a bit more advanced. But you can nicely see, so in the week you have the typical rush hour morning and evening, but in the weekends all people in the morning are still in their bed or not in the traffic jam. So okay, let's leave it there. So of course it's well only a short introduction, so there are many things that I didn't talk about, typical things that you want to do with data, or you can, for example, do in database, joins, merges, many other methods to reshape your data, work with missing data, there is a lot of functionality, and there is much more. I provided here some pointers if you are interested to do some more, but yeah, there are many good tutorials online and the pandas documentation. Voilà.